So, since today is Holy Humor Sunday, I thought we'd start with a couple jokes. What do you think? So a pastor was speaking to a group of second graders about the resurrection of Jesus when one student asked, "What did Jesus say right after he came out of the grave?" The pastor explained that the Gospels don't tell us exactly what he said right when he came out of the grave. And the hand of a little girl shot up. She said, "I know what he said." He said, "Ta-da!" Then the second joke I have for today is actually from George Burns. And he said, "The secret of a good sermon is to have a good beginning and a good ending, and to have the two as close together as possible." You gotta love good jokes. And luckily these were good jokes because he laughed. That was even better. But what's fun also is you can find humor within scripture. Sometimes we read scripture and we take it so seriously and that we miss the nuances. We miss the humor that's there. Like, I love the story from John 21 where there's Jesus on the shore after his resurrection calling out to the disciples, and Peter is on the boat. And as soon as Peter recognizes that it's Jesus on the shore, what does he do? He jumps off the boat and swims to shore, right? And then it says that the rest of the disciples stayed in the boat and went to shore with him, and they got to shore about the same time. Why did he get out of the boat? You know, and every time I think of that story, I think of the scene from Forrest Gump, where Forrest Gump is on his shrimp boat going down, and he sees Lieutenant Dan on the pier and jumps off the boat. Why did he jump off the boat? Just pull it over to the pier. But see, these are the funny stories that sometimes you miss. Or the wedding at Cana, right? We talked about that. They ran out of wine. So what happens? Jesus is there with his mom. So what does she say? "Hey, Jesus, do something about it." What? Mom, come on. You know, you miss that. The going back and forth between the son and his mom. Come on, do something. But it's not time. Okay, you guys, bring over those jugs. Listen to what he says, right? It's exactly what happens. It's funny. It's hilarious. You can think of the playing going on between Jesus and his mom in that. Or the other story that I love is the feeding of the 5,000 that we see. In fact, in the story, Jesus tells his disciples, "Feed these people, go get food." And Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to even have a bite." Another of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" You know, you may not catch the humor in that, but it's like he asked them to go feed them, and we have Andrew going over saying, "Oh, here, this kid has a lunch. Here you go, Jesus. Feed him with this." So, well, you know the rest of the story. What did Jesus do? He took that boy's meager lunch and fed 5,000 people with it. So what Andrew may have been throwing up as sort of a sarcastic thing, Jesus turned into a meal for 5,000 people. There's humor to be found, and Jesus wants us to find humor. God wants us to know that God has a sense of humor. So we need to recognize that. It is that kind of humorous twist in which God does something totally unexpected that is the basis for today, Holy Humor Sunday. See, Holy Humor Sunday is an old Easter custom begun by the Greeks in the early centuries of Christianity. Holy Humor Sunday celebrations of Jesus' resurrection on the Sunday after Easter. For centuries, the Eastern Orthodox, Catholic, and Protestant countries, the week following Easter Sunday, including Bright Sunday, the Sunday after Easter, was observed by the faithful as days of joy and laughter with parties and picnics, to celebrate Jesus' resurrection. Hence why I've got sort of the 4th of July picture going on up here. That's what I think, you know, the celebrations that we have around 4th of July where people gather for picnics and parties and everything else, this is what was happening in the early church. Churchgoers and pastors played practical jokes on each other, drenched each other with water, told jokes, sang, and danced. Thought about the super soaker, but then thought better of it. I've made mistakes like that before, so. The custom was rooted in the musings of early church theologians like Augustine, Gregory of Nyssa, and John Chrysostom, that God played a practical joke on the devil by raising Jesus from the dead. Risus Paschalis, the Easter laugh, the early theologians like to call it. The Easter laugh. It's this twist. God humbled himself and came as a human, came as Jesus Christ. This was an opportunity, a time when God was, in Satan's idea, vulnerable. And Jesus went to that cross and died. But it wasn't the end of the story. God had a twist to add to that story, and Easter came. And what was dead was no longer dead, but alive. What an amazing thing. Gotta love those twists. I know this is dating myself a bit, but this kind of humor with the twist in the end reminds me of the story twist that Paul Harvey used in his daily radio show. When he'd always say something to the effect that, now you know the rest of the story. Paul Harvey would tell stories that you kind of knew what was going on, you kind of knew about the person, but then he'd add a twist in the end that you weren't prepared for or that you didn't know. And these are the kind of twists that we see even today. In our scripture passage for today, we have that other such story with a twist to it. We hear about doubting Thomas, and unfortunately, Thomas has gotten a bad rap for that one little piece. Pastor Kate talked the other week about it. It was Thomas who was the encourager, saying to the disciples, yes, let's follow Jesus back to Jerusalem. Let's go back into that area again. Even though it's dangerous, let's go with Jesus, trusting that all would be well, that all would be in God's will. But then we have this story where Jesus has died, and Thomas is struggling and trying to figure out, you know, is he really risen? Has Jesus come back? And he needed to see the evidence. He needed to see the wounds. He needed to see the scar in the side. But is that the rest of the story for Thomas? Is Thomas for all time now just someone who doubted, someone who needed to see in order to believe? I heard a story when I was in seminary that really intrigued me when it came to Thomas. And it was by one of my professors of Old Testament from India. And he told the story of how when some of the first merchants and missionaries got to India, they were surprised to find that Christianity was already there. So let me share a little bit about the rest of the story of Thomas. Various historical records and traditions indicate that Thomas traveled by sea to India in CE 52. He was later martyred and buried there after witnessing to the Indian people. The tomb of St. Thomas in Mylapore, India. A poet, St. Ephrem, recorded in his hymns and poetry that Thomas worked miracles in the Indian city of Edessa. A Syrian ecclesiastical calendar has an entry which reads, 3rd July, St. Thomas, who was pierced with a lance in India. His body is in Urhai, Edessa, having been brought there by the merchant Cabin. A tradition observed by the people of Edessa honors Thomas, calling him the Apostle of India. Many other accounts and traditions mention Thomas in connection with India. So here we have Thomas, one of the disciples. Yes, he doubted, but he also heard the Great Commission, right? When Jesus told them to go into all the world and spread the good news, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But we never really heard specifically in the scripture story where Thomas went. But he took that Great Commission seriously. So even though he may be known by some as the person who doubted, he's also the person that took on boldly what Christ asked him to do and went off to India. So the rest of the story of Thomas is an amazing evangelism trip that he took to India, where he spread the gospel there and started the church there. What an amazing story that is. I think these twists in which God does something unexpected in the lives of others, like Thomas, proves that God has an amazing sense of humor. It truly proves that God turns conventional wisdom on its head. What then is the rest of our story? Thomas's doubting was not the rest of his story, as we just heard. Peter's denial of Jesus was not the rest of his story, because he did become the rock on which Christ built the church. We see that in Pentecost, which we'll talk about soon. Saul's time as a persecutor of the Christians was not the rest of his story, because he eventually became Paul, who helped to spread the gospel to the Gentiles and start many churches. Jesus' death on a cross was not the rest of his story, because we are Easter people with a resurrected Savior. My troubled youth as a kid was not the rest of my story, because God had something more in store for me as well. What story twist does God have in store for your story that will be a blessing to you and to others? I want you to ponder this week. God likes these twists where we think things are going one way, but then comes in and does something and makes it go another way. Sometimes we think our story is going one path, which may not be going where we think it should go or whatever, but God has a desire to take that story and move it in a different direction that will be a blessing to others, that will make a difference in the world. Are we looking for that twist that God has in store? Ponder that this week as Easter people, as people celebrating what God is choosing and desiring and wanting to do through God's will in this world. And maybe that twist that God has in store for you will take you in a direction you never imagined that you might go. Like I said, I loved Paul Harvey's radio show and how he would tell the rest of the story. Now, as I was researching some of his radio shows, I found something that he closed one of his Easter messages with. And he said this about Jesus. He said, "Jesus lived a good life in a wicked world to show us that it could be done. He died and he rose again to show us that we could do that too." Jesus showed a twist. Jesus showed that even in a wicked world, that we could be good people, that we could do good things, that we could do things that we weren't having to be subject to the wickedness, that we could choose good. Jesus also showed that death didn't have the final say, because God has the final power when it comes to those things. So people, now you know the rest of the story. And as he would always close, good day. Amen.